Hello, welcome everyone. Another year, another lecture series. So welcome to Sliver 1920. This academic year is devoted to futures, as the title Greater Futures suggests. The future is a hot topic nowadays. It is complex and globally interconnected. It is uncertain yet inevitable. So according to Jim Dantor, the future cannot be predicted, but alternative futures can be forecasted and preferred futures envisioned and invented continuously. So we are moving the conversation on futures into an imaginative direction, and who to give a better start than our guest tonight. Creating new worlds and tearing down boundaries. This is how Wideshot operates. Their scope of work spans from building sci-fi worlds for Hollywood productions to research and work on future scenarios for cities, buildings, and entertainment, which are turned into reality. Oliver Bertram, who is with us tonight, studied architecture at the ETH Zurich. He taught with Greg Lynn at the ETH and here at the Angewandte for over a decade, I think, right? For quite a long time. He was also a senior scientist at the University of Art and Design in Linz. And in 2010, Oliver founded Wideshot Design together with Johannes Mücke, who is also a graduate of the Institute of Architecture here at the University of Applied Arts in Vienna, and whose professional path took him through architecture, concept design, and art direction. Wideshot delivers professional work in the fields of architecture, interior design, film, and gaming. And through its experience and know-how, the design studio provides support for companies around the world for projects in the fields of architecture, interior design, theme park architecture, games, and film. Wideshot's clients include 20th Century Fox, Sony Pictures Entertainment, Ubisoft, Disney, Lotus Renault Formula One, Audi, BMW, and Rockstar Games. They have won awards like the German Design Award for Interior Architecture and the Austrian Mobility Award 2019. They participated in the Vienna Design Week, animation and gaming conferences, film festivals, and much more. Today's lecture is titled What If? And we'll show the potential of posing questions, even if these are hypothetical ones, to create visions and scenarios. So I'm looking forward to a journey through fiction and reality, and would like to give over to Oliver.
So, thank you, Maja. For everybody who doesn't know it, Maja took my job. I can't believe. Did you look it up? Did I work here for more than 10 years?
Yes, LinkedIn says.
Oh my God. Okay. Thank you very much. It's great to be here after, I think I have not been here for about 7 years. So there's a new building that was open, everything is refurbished, even this space here, it looks almost brand new, even though it's very old. So my name is Oliver Bertram. I want to give you a sliver today, a little slice of a lot of projects to show what we do and to show what if two crazy guys meet and decide to do something completely different from their regular business, what is coming out in the work span or lifespan of 9 years. So we have a company sitting here in Vienna in the city center, and you heard we have BMW, Rockstar Games, 20th Century Fox as our clients, but we never decided to go anywhere else. Currently, Johannes Mücke, my partner, was supposed to be here, but with our daily life business, it also comes along that we travel a lot. So Johannes is in Los Angeles, probably at exactly this moment, working with Roland Emmerich on a new blockbuster movie, I will show one image of this, and then you have to wait until the end of next year when it's going to be in the cinema. So this is me and Johannes Mücke, and these two guys have thought 10 years ago about how can we combine our skills to define something new, to add to the world of architecture, to add to the world of design. And we came up with one diagram, and it's... After 9 years, for sure, we would never have achieved that without our team. And it's blame on me that I forgot to mention our team. And our team loves laser tagging. So we have about 25 people working with us here in Vienna. I think that's only a part. There's a couple of them is added this year because we had to finish a couple of larger projects. So we're two junkies for the question, what if? So Johannes, Mücke and me, we never really cared too much about is this actually feasible on the construction side. We had to learn that this is quite necessary if you want to make some money with your work. But on the other hand, we also found fields where it is not so necessary and we can actually gain a totally different audience than we would have without thinking outside the box. So our box is actually a triangle, and this triangle is what we thought in the beginning. So we made this up and said this is what we want to achieve. So we have architecture on the one side, on the other side we have entertainment. Why entertainment? Johannes, after he graduated here, also from Studio Lynn, he went to London to work there for Rashid Mousavi and for FRA. And then he decided, okay, this sucks. I want to go in the computer gaming industry, and he started to work with Rockstar. And Rockstar, if does anybody know Rockstar? So Rockstar Games, Comedia, okay. So Rockstar was pretty cool, and they had an office here in Vienna, and they closed down. But Mücke was hooked and specialized in entertainment. So when we met and we decided we want to open a company in 2010, we said, okay, there's architecture and design on the one hand, and there's entertainment on the other hand, and there must be a result of this, which we call entertainment architecture, a field that is beyond what we understand as the field of architecture, as an authorship, as an individual design language that you have, but merely following the idea of entertaining or basically like pleasing the crowds or finding a good idea that kind of cheers the life a little bit. So our what if questions that I want to show you tonight are the what if questions that we had. It's just a small selection. I have two or three slides of each project. It's just a small selection of what we were developing during the time, and it starts long time before actually Wideshot was founded, and even long time before I met Johannes Mücke. So the question was, and that was actually, this question was not posed by me. It was posed by Greg Lynn, who is a professor here, and I was a student at the ETH in Zurich. And it was the question, what if we had a fully customizable, parametric, robotic manufactured house? And this is the Ozvaldic house. For those who have no idea what this is, it's worth reading it. At my time, it was the hottest, newest shit. Now it's probably a part of your architecture history books. And it looked like this. So organic forms on computers were just made possible. And the idea of Greg was, I'm inventing a house that's completely organic shaped. And these are all spheres. So it's very simple to do. And they're all sliced down in about, I think, 1,024 pieces. So he said it's completely customizable, so you get any shape that you can think of. So there are millions of different paths to start, and it was fully parametric. Certainly it was never robotic manufactured, and there's not a single one of this that was ever built. But, and now there's my contribution, there was one guy who figured out in Switzerland how to CNC mill this on a computer milling machine, together with Marcelin Garo, who's now teaching at SIAC, and also has an office that's called Servo. And so, a team of 2, 3, 4 people working for Greg developed a way to create a code, a machining code, to CNC mill this, and then how to cut it down into pieces and find a CNC mill that was big enough in Switzerland to actually manufacture this, and then assemble this on the Venice Biennale in the year 2000. And this thing is, I think, about 4 meters, 5 meters high, it's 6 meters wide, it cantilevers about 3.5 meters from the wall. And in the end, Greg decided to give it a very certain color, and this is why my personal title for this piece is the Smurf. But as a starting point, at that time, that was the largest CNC manufactured piece in architecture. So the second is 2008. 8 years later, I was teaching here, and I also had, at the same time, I had a small office with two of my students working for me, mostly set up in my own home. And there was a guy coming up to me saying, I have a question. I have a client, I'm just building an industrial shed, and there's a kid's play park in there. And they need a spaceship. And they hire the designer, and then I waited a year for a result, and they find that the result looks kind of weird, and they don't know if this is possible even to manufacture. And after I was so involved into CNC manufacturing, they asked me, okay, can you check if this model that they built can be manufactured? And very short answer, the model was a disaster in Rhino, and we figured it's actually impossible to build it, and the question of the client was, can you fix it? And in that moment I said something that that I didn't know would have so many consequences. I said, like, no, I'd better design it myself again. And he said, well, you have 1 week. And 6 days later, we designed that. On the night when he asked me, you have 1 week, I called Mücke and I said, Mücke, I have a problem, I need a spaceship within 6 days. And the spaceship needs to fit into this boundary box, whatever. It was very complicated. And it looks kind of small, and actually it's pretty big. It's finally ended up, I think it's still the biggest CNC manufactured piece that is built in Europe. This is the inner structure. It's a steel structure that was set up prefabricated. Also, for anybody who is in the construction business, a little bit we had from scratch design, from the first design that we had to opening, about 3.5 months. So we didn't have the time to design, so we were designing while we were building, which was quite interesting. So this is the setup spaceship interior. These are the individual pieces, all CNC milled. I think, Betsy, you have been, no, you both have been there, huh?
In the production.
Yeah, we went there. And so really, really big pieces, and they needed to be fitting into trucks, so we had to cut them down a little bit. They were test assembled in the building there, so to see if all the pieces are fitting. This was kind of an advanced CNC Tetris in a large scale. So the final result was assembled, and you can see there's this brown box here. And this brown box has a reason, because we were designing from the inside to a boundary box and from the outside to the inside to a boundary box, because we didn't have time to do it in one piece. So there was one guy working against one layer, and another guy was working against the other side of the layer, and this layer is these wooden planks here. So everything finally was fitting. It took 2 weeks to install this, and this is the night of the opening. And on the night of the opening, there was one guy still painting, and this photo was taken by Tom Beck, the photographer of Philip Stark, which I love that he did it. And this is the guy who painted it half transparent. So this thing is actually really giant. It has about 900 square meter interior space. It has 3 levels interior, and among the steepest slides that are allowed for kids in Europe. So you can go in and slide on. It's actually fun. So you can see what I really like is the way that how we seamed the individual pieces. It looks like an aerospace element, even though it's like massive CNC milled foam that is then coated. So you can imagine how steep these slides are. And that was actually the starting point, almost the starting point. Yes?
And can I just ask what material it was made of?
Like the it's a material that is used for building stage sets, and it's EPS foam, CNC milled, and then coated with polyurethane foam. It's like, you know, do you remember the old NCs? Does anybody know what NCs are? Okay, only the old guys. Only the old guys here. So it's a big foam piece, and it's you spray a layer of plastics on the top, and the plastic hardens, and that's it. It's if you do it right, you get pretty cool, pretty nice surfaces, but there are not many companies that do it well, I think. So there was one step missing before Wideshot could be founded, even though I was not even thinking about founding Wideshot because I had my own firm. And but Mücke, after he worked with me on the spaceship, he got another commission. And the guy called that he knew from skiing and said, like, hey, my brother, he's working in Los Angeles on a movie. He needs a comic strip. He needs a small animated comic strip, and it has to look like somebody has done it without knowing how to draw, which is a problem because Mücke, if somebody ever saw anything he's drawn, he's probably the most amazing guy on the pencil that I know. And it turned out this guy was the brother of Harald Loza, the producer of Roland Emmerich. So Roland Emmerich's movie at that time in 2008 was the production for 2012. And so Mücke ended up, he was designing a comic strip as a flip book, and then he was drawing it with his right hand, and then he took the pencil and sticky tape, and he sticked the pencil to his left hand and then drew it again. And you can see the result here.
Ian?
Yeah.
So look, I gotta eat. Why don't you download my blog? It's free. Of course we do. Appreciate donations.
In ancient times, the Mayan people were the first civilization to discover that this planet had an expiration date. According to their calendar, in the year 2012, a cataclysmic event will unfold caused by an alignment of the planet in our solar system that only happens every 640,000 years.
I did all the animation myself.
Just imagine the Earth as an orange.
You lure them in with humor, then you make them think.
Our sun will begin to emit such extreme amounts of radiation,
some little bastard you call it,
that the core of the Earth will melt at the inside part of the orange, leaving the crust of our planet free to shift. In 1958, Professor Charles Hapgood named it Earth Crust Displacement. Albert Einstein did support it. People will get it all. The forces of Mother Nature will be so devastating, it will bring an end to this world on Wednesday, 12/21/12. Always remember, folks, you heard it first from Charlie Brooks.
You have to keep a thing like this.
So, thank God we're trained architects. So the next thing was, we founded Wideshot in 2010. A friend of ours had the idea. I was actually working in a different company at that time, and he had the idea, okay, Oliver, you are currently working for a different company on a project that you kind of brought yourself into this firm, and why don't you open an office? And after the credit crunch in 2009, which was pretty harmful to all architecture firms, I decided that I would love to start another company and I would not do it alone. And what we did, I asked Mücke if he wants to join, and we founded the company. That's a short story, all the rest is pretty long. But one of the early things that we had was we got a commission for a super luxury housing that was supposed to be not inhabited for a couple months a year, but is in one of the most harsh environments on the planet. in Mongolia, actually in Ulaanbaatar. And the owner is one of the, let's say, the most successful businessmen in this country. And he designed a house that looked like this. And it looks like this because of many reasons, but one of the major reasons is it needed to be able to sustain itself on a 12 degree temperature level even during winter. And winter in Mongolia means minus 40 degrees. So I think we spent about $1.5 million in drilling geothermal pipes into the ground. So it was a lot of effort, but actually we were able to extract enough heat or enough warmth from the ground to get this calculation working. So we designed it from scratch, from the very first brick to the very last button on the interior. And it certainly has a big garage, a big show garage. It has a big pool. It's about 3,000 square meter for a couple. And actually the couple lives on about like 1,400 square meters, which is it's getting quite packed and narrow in there. So that's the entrance area. And that's all this interior is also designed. The house itself was designed by Sebastian Kraus, who's a former Angewandte graduate. The interior is designed by Miriam Gabrielic, a former Angewandte graduate. But what we did not know is how long it takes to build in a country that has only 3 months or 4 months of no frost. And otherwise everything is completely hard. So designing the interior was a little bit outdated in the moment we were finished with the concrete works. But now this is from, I think, this spring. And you can see it's a really, really amazing area there. It's about 30 kilometers outside Ulaanbaatar to the north. And you can see how it sits in the landscape. It's an area that's actually bordering a national park. And this is how it was looking in October this year. So it's getting really, really nice. But you can imagine if it's minus 40 degrees, probably you don't want to live there all the whole winter. So it's a very nice project, and it's been going on for so long I even forgot that we did that until I got the last images. So one of our major business fields that we actually have financial turnover is designing interiors for offices, and we are quite successful in there. And going through all the possibilities that you have in offices will take quite a while. And I just want to give you an insight into one big step that we had. And we had the idea in the year about 2015 that we want to make the workplace more democratic. And there's an Austrian businessman, his name is Kari Kapsch, owns a company that is called Kapsch Carriercom. He's the owner. And therefore, he's the only guy who can decide what's happening in the company. And he said, I want my staff to decide how they want to work. And what we did is we actually invented a set of cubes. A set of cubes, 9 cubes. I named it the 9-square grid, if anybody of you is familiar with this. Has anybody heard that before? No, I explain you. It's Cooper Union. Cooper Union, first year's architecture student test. And this 9-square grid, these 9 cubes, have 6 sides. And the idea is that you put whatever decision you have as an individual on one side, so everybody can just decide by gut feeling very quickly. And the topics you have to decide on is on the top. So you would play this and you would decide by rotating these cubes and setting them down with the new choice on top. And we have a photo box that is customized so we can just push it in and take a photo and take it out and give it to the next one. That works pretty well in workshops. And it's really democratic because you have a 100% transparent result and everybody knows what they have decided on. And on the in final effect, they know how their decision has influenced this democratic process. And the result is that the shipping department gets a cargo area as their sofa area, Then we have another department in the computer design or software design area. They called it the North Pole. They said, okay, we want it white. Just flash white, and this is what they got. It actually works pretty well. And the most funny thing is this one. These were the hardware guys that designed hardware on the computer and then sent an order to Taiwan, and they received the part. And they said, we want a workshop again. We used to, like 10 years ago, we had a workshop. We want a workshop. So they got the workshop as a conference area. All the rest of the, so we have like 26, 27, 28 different spaces in this small firm. And all the rest was supposed to be very plain and very simple designed to not to influence this multiplicity of spaces. And it turns out the Kapsch Group has several companies. It turns out that the employees in this company are a lot more satisfied and happy with their work environment than the ones in the other companies that actually also have really nice interiors. So, Mücke always does the same thing. What if the world comes to an end, part two? So we have multiple parts of ending the story of this planet, and also in the career of Wideshot, I think we have destroyed the White House about 3 times. So, only movies. In 2014, actually, we were asked if there's a possibility that we can start designing for Independence Day Resurgence. Again, blockbuster movie by Roland Emmerich. There is a connection there between Mücke and Bohr. They actually really are inspiring themselves in an absolutely magic way. And we have a very, very extensive documentation how the design worked. If anybody has seen the movie, the world gets destroyed. There are aliens, there are spaceships, there are fighters, and we built about 10 cities in 2 weeks. And I want to go through one thing, which is the major small spaceship that happens to appear in this movie. And this spaceship is called the Moontar. And just to go through this very, very computer-based design, this is the first design that was done by Mücke, and I think it's just genius. You see the sticky tape on the ground, and the problem was to build a spaceship as a set piece, you have to transport it under highway bridges, so it can't be too big. So this sticky tape boundary is actually the minimum possible space to shoot the scenes that are in the script. So they would stand there with the camera and see with the aperture if this is actually fitting onto the screen or not. So that was the starting point. And from that starting point, there was a 3D model built around it. And this 3D model is the first one that was built. It was built in Maya. And you can see the idea was to have a little floating spaceship that has 2 giant arms that it actually stands on, it sits on, and it can actually move as forklift arms. Certainly it had to fly, and then you get, this is how the things then look when they finished and polished for presentation. The idea of Independence Day Resurgence was the human beings have actually gotten a hold of this alien technology. They didn't really know how to use it, but they put it in a box and tried to fly with it, and it somehow worked. And this is the kind of the engine module that we added to all the spaceships and fighter jets and so on. And then we switched to Rhino to make it more precise, to get real drawings out of it, and to finish this design. And it went pretty well, because in the end, we had a result that looked like that. That's a set piece that's in a big hall in Albuquerque. This is Johannes here. It's a big piece that sits in the set, and it actually performed really well in the movie.
so that they... So we'll call a cab.
Thanks for doing this, Jake.
Let's get moving though, because the guy stole this thing.
Jake's jealous to move around different parts in his space tank. A space tank is basically a truck or a forklift with retractable arms.
No, that's all right.
I haven't kicked down the fusion drive yet.
Yeah. I was blown away first time I saw it. It weighs around 40 tons, which is pretty impressive for a set piece. It's a lot of fun.
You destroyed one of my tugs.
Like that? No, that's just cosmetic.
You can fix that.
Next, what if? So, again, the world is ending. Oh my god. So, after we got more and more into the film business, we actually figured out that our business licenses in the US are not really valid, so that we can be a regular vendor in the US. So we needed to be kind of an accredited vendor in Europe first. And after doing Independence Day Resurgence and working on different movies, we had the idea, okay, instead of working on five little movie productions in Europe, let's do a little short film in Vienna and look ahead an idea for a script. And do this and perform all these works on our side and get the credits from the European, from the IMDb database. It was a good idea. Actually, it turned out to be like a lot more work and cost than we expected. But on the other hand, it's a great piece of 11 minutes film. And the story is the moment when the artificial intelligence becomes super intelligent, so it's starting to fight the human beings. And I have two little films that are about 2 minutes. The first one is a trailer, the second one is a making of piece. Oh, and it's it was on different festivals in the US so far. It goes to film festivals, and hopefully it will go and be shown in Austria soon. Unfortunately, I cannot show it because if I show it here, it will not be accepted for a premiere at the Biennale, for example.
Thank you.
making films always produces a lot of really beautiful imagery. That's the time. That was a project that we just finished recently. And the question is, what is now? So what did we just finish, or what are we just working on? And the one thing that just got into the movie is another end of the world. It's not the end of the world, but it almost would have been the end of the American Pacific Fleet, is the movie Midway that was just published, I think, 3 weeks ago by Roland Emmerich, and I have another clip for you. This is German now, I'm sorry, I couldn't find an English one.
Da bist du ein Junge. Er dachte, er schafft es nicht. Ich hab's nur für die übliche Nervosität gehalten. Und ihn unter meine Fittiche genommen. Seine Angst war berechtigt. Das größte geheimdienstliche Versagen der amerikanischen Geschichte. Das darf nie wieder passieren. Ich will es wieder gut machen. Ich sitze in der paar Jungs dabei, die noch kämpfen wollen. Die Japaner planen was Großes.
Also, was ist das Ziel?
Vermutlich die Midway-Insel. Washington ist anderer Meinung. Washington liegt falsch. Wenn wir verlieren, gehört die Westküste den Japanern. Seattle, San Francisco, Los Angeles werden brennen.
Wir haben den Befehl anzugreifen. Wir müssen ihnen einen Schlag versetzen, damit sie spüren, wie sich ein Treffer anfühlt.
Wir sprechen von ein paar Dutzend Flugzeugen gegen die gesamte japanische Flotte. Wie soll ich diese Männer anführen?
Sie wollen den überall.
Wenn du mich in Gefahr gestellt hast, weil sie andere auf dich gezählt haben, dann bist du allem gewachsen.
That is what we have to do right now. This is why Mücke is not here. There's this movie production currently called Moonfall. If you want to look it up on IMDb, there's an excerpt of the synopsis is in there. And it looks like everything is going to be extremely well designed. but I cannot tell you much more about it. So Mücke is apologizing, he cannot be here. And then the other thing is that I'm working on, and also it's a major part of my currently work on the future, is a project that started in 2018, actually started in 2016 with this Chinese EV automated driving company. And I had the idea, okay, how are the cities changing when you have autonomous cars? Currently it changed a little bit to how are the cities changing when you have autonomous cars and mobility as a service, and basically how does real estate change. And it's a very technical topic, but it's interesting because it spreads out to a gigantic and enormous size. So if you look at the car right now, a car needs about 2.5 by 5 meter to be part, which is 12.5 square meters. Not much. It's about what an average Austrian kid's room has. So in the city of Vienna, you have about 720,000 cars that are licensed within the city. And if you calculate this with an amount of 2.5, sorry, I missed one. Sorry, I missed about this one. And you have 2.5 parking spots in average to be in the city in order that traffic works. Because when you leave your house and get into your car to get to the grocery store, you expect that there is a parking space for you. And this is not happening, you cannot stop your car. So you cannot wait until somebody else is freeing the space. So the average ratio is 2.5. So this means within the city limits of Vienna, we have 22 million square meters within the city of parking spaces. And if we have autonomous cars, mobility as a service, we can probably free about 80% of this, which is 17.6 million square meters. And the mechanism behind this is that cars are actually only operated 1 hour a day, and they're standing just on the street and wait for the driver about 23 hours. So the goal of mobility as a service and so-called robo-taxis like Tesla published an announcement last year that in 2020 they're going to operate a fleet of autonomous robo-taxis. The idea is to turn this the other way around, so that the cars only are stopped for an hour and are moving 23 hours. So what we did, and to make this really, really short, we took away about 80% of the parking spots. We took 3 spaces in the first district of Vienna because they are the most parking spots per capita in the city. And in these 3 areas, we just made an imagination how the city could change if you remove all the parking spots and you put this area to a better and more people-oriented use. And this is in walking distance, about 20 minutes from here. This is Börsegasse. And I started the lecture on this topic first and reporting that we have 5 lanes of parked cars, and nobody would believe me, but now you can count yourself. And if you know the space a little bit, you know that around here there's another underground parking lot underneath it. So there are probably a couple hundred cars in the blue that you have. And the idea that we have is changing this street in the future to something that might look like this, or even different, but more livable than it is today, and more inhabitable and cooler, and also allowing more biodiversity. This is what I'm looking for personally in a positive future, and we start to work on this in a very active way. We probably will have the first city to change the streets within 2020. And, oh, I wanted to take this out, sorry. Well, you can see it, that's the same street again. It's a different view. You can see there's even a little gas station in the back. And there you can see how it's changed by its length. So what next is a question that always comes to our mind. We have a lot of projects that are coming up. But the good thing is, actually, we have a lot to do. And I wanted to say, yes, we are hiring. So if anybody graduates, now you start, perfect. I know you're talented, but you're lazy. So we're actually looking for architects, for production designers, and for interior designers to help our team. So feel free to apply, especially when you graduate. So then, let's go. Thank you very much. coming first. Currently, if you are interested in it, in Phoenix, Arizona, there are the first areas where Waymo drives without safety driver. So there's literally no one in the car drives itself. Yes, fine.
Did you also have projects with the gaming industry?
Oh yes, plenty.
Because you should,
We're working on Hitman, on Assassin's Creed, on Siedler, on, oh my god, I don't play most of the games. So there's tons, there's really tons, because in the concept art area, the projects are very short, and so they're probably going on for a month or two or three, and therefore you collect like 10 or 12 a year. So we have a lot, and there was also an own exhibition on concept art that was done by Johannes in the Wien Energy art show in, what is it called? By the Sahara-Draußen. So it's, there's a lot there, and also there's still a lot going on. But currently we try to focus more, if possible, on the movies. So everybody's shocked. Was it surprising? Was it surprising?
Yeah.
Yes.
How much does the architecture, or like what you've learned about the architecture, influence then designs like in movies or in the industry? Or is it mostly like the tools you've learned that you've done implement?
No. I think the conceptual design thinking in architecture helps a lot. Also, there's a lot of architecture or architecture related elements in movies. Like even spaceships are set up in components, they need to be connected, and the spaceship we've seen is a lot more architectural than it is like a vehicle design, because this vehicle design is much more of creating one piece. This is creating a bunch of interconnected pieces. So I would think architecture helps a lot, and the way you are taught here to learn how architecture works, the concepts on it, the formal concepts on it, is actually giving you a really good set of design understanding to be able to carry out these completely different tasks in design. Because thinking in an abstract way about design, how design works, is a lot better than just training one type of, let's say, surface or architectural or design language.
What is the proportion between game design, film design, and architecture in your firm?
We do about, it's differing a lot, but we do about 35% of interior design, 30-35% of architecture, and about something between 20-30% of game and film. But film is also a lot differing because we have crunch times, then when you have to submit something, you're working for like 4 months with a team of 8 or 10 people on one set, and then it's getting reduced to zero. So architecture and interior design is much more steady in the amount of work that we have.
Is it the same team that is working on architecture then?
Yes.
Really?
Yes. Well, we have team members that are specialized, for example, in interior carpenter details. So they don't do spaceships, obviously. But it's not many. I think we only have about 3 really specialized people in the office. So, and also, I think it's cool. You know, you have, we do a lot of like straightforward architecture that I didn't show them, like rectangular and simple and industrial prefab windows and stuff like that. And if you work on this for half a year, actually, and somebody comes up and says, hey, do you like to do a spaceship? I think it's a good reward for what we have in here.
I have a question about promotion. So usually nowadays about promotion.
The promotion?
Yeah, promotion of firm. So usually nowadays it is way more easier to promote the, let's say, one trick firm. But is it difficult to promote the company which has completely different direction of development? It's like different audience, different clients, yeah. Different markets,
yeah.
And so on.
It's, I have to say, in retrospective, starting a company that wants to design, wants to combine architecture and entertainment is a pretty stupid idea. you have to think about this in a way that there's no market for what you do. So when you start to do something, oh, we do everything. No, we do. We have a very precise decision on what jobs we do. It's an internal thing, but it's called 4+1F, and we always have to come up with a certain result so that we do the job. But on the other hand, from people outside, it might look like, oh, they do what? They do kids' spaceships and car manufacturing plants, and what is the relation between this? There's a lot of design relation, but for many clients, it's not so obvious. And this is exactly what you say. It's a very good point. The problem is that many people are not really getting their head around that design is an abstraction of dealing with a problem, rather than just painting a nice solution. And therefore, yes, it's difficult for people to understand. It was probably a job about, like, it took about 6 years for companies to understand, or for clients to really understand that there's no difference in quality, or we might be even better. But we have a good result, we have a lot of work right now, and I'm happy that we created our own market.
Yes.
With regard to your work in the film industry, are you guys specifically like the Starship guys, or is there other types of scenography and set design?
No. We also did Midway. We did storyboards and titles for Midway, and we did the key artworks for Maya Lord. And so this is going to come out next year in the movies, which is set in, I think, 1512 in Central America. So it's also historic. We don't have this boundary of just doing future things. We prefer to do future things because we have this idea that the combination of science and a utopia and also a dystopia is more interesting for us than resembling the past. So. But no, we don't want to be only the sci-fi guys. So we really love to tackle each problem on its own.